Okay, we are discussing the notion of vector spaces. We had seen several examples. Let's now look at a few properties of that hold in a vector space. Before that, let's go back to the axioms. The existence of negative element. Okay, that is the axiom corresponding to the existence of a negative element for every U element of V. I mentioned that there exists V element of V such that U plus V equals 0. Okay. Now this V, such a V is unique, that can be proved easily. I want to introduce a notation. This notation is just to appeal to our intuition. It's an additive inverse, so we'll call it the negative element. We'll denote it by minus u. See, this is just a notation presently. We don't know what this means. Okay, this. What we know is that this is a vector in V which satisfies this equation. So minus u is that unique vector V that satisfies this equation. Okay. I want to discuss four properties that hold in a vector space. Four elementary properties which we'll be using on many occasions. Let V be a vector space. Then the following hold. The following properties hold. First property. Alpha into 0 equals 0. This is true for all alpha element of F. Hereafter, I'll write R for F. This these properties hold for C also. Okay. So unless I specify, the underlying field will be the field of real numbers for all alpha element of R. Let's observe that this is a scalar multiplication. Okay. Scalar vector. So this 0 is a 0 vector. The right hand side vector is also the 0 vector. Okay. Property 2, 0 times u equals 0 for all u element of V. This time you need to differentiate. The 0 on the left is a scalar 0 that comes from the field, the additive identity. The 0 on the right is a vector 0. This holds for all u. Property 3. If alpha into u equal to 0, then either alpha equal to 0 or u equal to 0. Okay. Again, we are using the same 0 for scalar as well as vector. So let's understand that this 0 is the vector 0. This is scalar 0. Yeah, this is again vector 0. That's property 3. Property 4. It's a only with regard to property 4 that I wanted to use this notation. So what property 4 says is minus 1 times u is minus u for all u element of V. So minus u is precisely minus 1 times u, minus 1 into u. Okay, these are elementary properties. Quick proof. For proving 1 and 2, I'll use the following result. The equation x plus x equals x for x and v has, so can you say something about x? X must be 0. The equation x plus x equal x for x and v has x equal to 0 as the only solution. As x equal to 0 as the only solution. Okay, let's prove this. Once we have this, properties 1 and 2 will follow immediately. Okay, let's prove this quickly. What is the reason? So I have x plus x equals x, and I will add minus x to it. I know that minus x is in the vector space, that is minus x is the negative of x. Just now I introduced that notation. So I add minus x plus x plus x, that is minus x plus x. Minus x plus x, I know this is a negative element, so this is 0. I know that addition is associative, so minus x plus x plus x. Again use the fact that this is 0. 0 plus x equals 0, but I know that 0 plus x is x, so x is equal to 0. So if this holds for x, then x must be 0, and clearly 0 satisfies this equation. Okay, so 0 is the only solution of this equation. Let's now consider the proof of 1. I'll set x to be alpha into 0. Okay, then alpha into 0 is alpha into 0 vector, which can be written as 0 plus 0. That is distributivity, alpha into 0 plus alpha into 0, that is x is equals x plus x. Just from what we have seen now, it follows that x is 0. Okay, that is the first one. I hope this is clear. It follows essentially from the fact that the equation x plus x equals x has x equal to 0 as the only solution. So that is the first one. Proof of the second. I will again set x as 0 into u. Then previously we used the vector 0, now we will use a scalar 0 and use the property that alpha plus beta times u is alpha u plus beta u. So look at x, that is 0 into u, that is 0 plus 0, this is a scalar 0 into u, that is 0 into u plus 0 into u, which is x plus x, and so x is equal to 0. Okay. So that is property 2. It is actually quite elementary. Okay. Property 3. We need to show that I am given that alpha into u is 0. We must show that either alpha is 0 or u is 0 or both. Okay. Okay. If alpha is 0, then there is nothing to prove. Let's take the case that alpha is not 0. Remember that alpha comes from R. Alpha is a real number, non-zero. Every non-zero real number, it's a field. So has a multiplicative inverse, that is 1 by alpha. So let's look at this equation. I pre-multiply this equation by 1 by alpha. 1 by alpha into u is 1 by alpha into 0. 1 by alpha into 0 is 0. 1 by alpha into alpha. I am using axiom 7. Alpha into beta u is alpha beta into u. 1 by alpha into u. 1 by alpha is the inverse of alpha. So this is 1. 1 times u. Condition axiom 8. 1 into u is u. U is 0. Okay. So that is. That is proving 3. Proof of 4, look at 0 times u. I start with this 0 into u. Okay. That is, I can write this as 1 plus minus 1 into u. This happens in the field. 0 is a scalar here. This happens in the field. 1 plus minus 1 is 0 in the field. This is 1 into u plus minus 1 into u. That is u plus minus 1 into u. I will add minus u on both sides. Zero into u I know is zero. Okay. Okay. So minus u plus zero on the left, minus u plus minus one into u. Minus u on the left, minus addition is associative. This is 0 plus minus 1 into u, that is just minus 1 into u. So we have shown that minus 1 into u is minus u. So the negative element that we denoted by minus u is minus 1 into u. Okay, okay. So this is quite elementary. Okay, let us proceed. We had looked at several examples yesterday, several examples of vector spaces. I will pick up one of them. We used this notation pk. I think I used pn yesterday, but I want to look at pk. Pk is the vector space, the real vector space of all polynomials of degree less than or equal to k for a fixed positive integer n, for a fixed positive integer k. This is a real vector space, by which I mean the coefficients coming from the field of real numbers. It is easy to see that for L less than or equal to k, take the non-trivial case, it is easy to see that PL is contained in PK strictly, and that this holds also PL is a vector space in its own right. PL is a vector space in its own right. Okay, since I have include equal to, I will include equal to here also. It is a vector space in its own right with respect to the same operations. Let us observe this. With respect to the same operations as you have in PK, same addition and scalar multiplication. Okay, so this motivates the definition of a subspace. Okay, which is what I want to discuss next. From this we will look at the notion of a subspace. It makes sense to say that PL is a subspace of PK whenever L is less than or equal to K. PL is a subspace of PK whenever L is less than or equal to K. What is a subspace? A subset W of a vector space V is called a subspace of V if W itself is a vector space with respect to the same operations by which I mean vector addition and scalar multiplication from V, with respect to the same operations in V. Such a subset, this is a special subset which is also a vector space. Such a subset is called a subspace of V. Okay, we have already seen an example. PL is contained in PK. PL is a subspace of PK whenever L is less than or equal to K. Let us look at other examples. But before that, to verify that these examples are indeed examples of subspaces, we need a device. So let us prove this result, which will be useful in the examples. So we have the following theorem for a subspace. For those of you who have studied group theory, this will not come as a surprise. A subset W of a vector space V is a subspace of V if and only if the following two conditions hold. First condition, x comma y in W implies x plus y is in W. It must be closed with respect to the vector addition, where this plus is the same as the addition in the vector space V. Only to emphasize, x element of W, alpha element of R implies alpha into x belongs to W. This is closure with respect to scalar multiplication. So one needs to verify just these two conditions to show that a certain subset is a subspace. Okay, just these two closure axioms really. Okay, let's prove this first and then look at examples of sort of prove this theorem. There are two parts. It's if and only if. There is a necessity part, there is a sufficiency part. If W is a subspace, that's the easy part. If W is a subspace, then this condition holds, that's the easy part. Let W be a subspace of V, then obviously W is a vector space. So 1 and 2 hold trivially because it's a vector space. It's a vector space in its own right. So one part is easy. If W is a subspace, then these two conditions hold. Okay, it's the converse that's interesting. Conversely, suppose that W is a subset of V such that conditions 1 and 2 hold. We must show that W is a subspace. Okay. Let's quickly write down the axioms of a vector space. Okay, this is also useful in recalling. The definition of a vector space. What are the axioms? First we must verify that it is closed. Okay, so x, y in W implies x plus y is in W. Then second condition, alpha in R, x in W implies alpha x is in W. These two are the closure axioms. These two axioms hold because conditions 1 and 2 have been assumed. Then associativity, x plus y plus z equals x plus y plus z for all x, y, z. This holds because these are elements of V, and in V associativity holds, so this equation holds. In W, commutativity, x plus y equals y plus x. That is, I am picking elements x and x, y and z. See, to emphasize, this is true for all x, y, z in W. I am writing down the axioms for W being a vector space. X and y are from W, but it does not matter. I am looking at x plus y in V, so these two are the same. So I have associativity, I have commutativity. So let me say this is there, this is there, this is there, this is there. I have all these four. Let me write down the other conditions. The other act for each x element of W, there exists y element of W such that x plus y is 0. This we do not have presently. We will prove this. Okay. Presently we do not have this. We will prove this. But what we have is x is in W, so x is in V. So I know there exists y in V such that x plus y is 0. Why should this y belong to W? We will show that this y will indeed be in W if those two conditions hold. Okay, but this right now we don't have. The next one is also not there. Well, even before this, look at this axiom. There exists zero in W such that x plus 0 equals x for all x in W. We need to verify this even before verifying this. What I know is that there exists 0 in V. Why should that 0? We will actually prove that 0 is in W also. Okay. So this we don't have presently. So we'll prove that this the 0 in V belongs to W, and then prove this existence of additive inverse. What are the other axioms then? So with respect to scalar multiplication, I have written down axiom 1. Axiom 2 is distributivity, alpha times x plus y. This is alpha x plus alpha y for all alpha in R, x, y in W. Again, this is true because this holds in V, and so this is true. Condition with regard to distributivity over the fields, alpha plus beta into x, that is alpha x plus beta x, alpha beta in R, x in W. This again is true. What else do we have? Alpha into beta x, this must be alpha beta into x, alpha beta in R, x in W. This again is true because this happens in the vector space V. Finally, 1 into x equals x for all x element of V, for all x element of W. We want this to hold in W. This is also true because if it is in W, it is in V, and for elements in V, this holds. So this is also true. We need to only verify these two conditions. First, 0 belongs to W, and that for every x in W, there is a negative element. Okay? Yes.
So why we need the theorem?
Yeah.
So what is the need of
the theorem? W is a subset in which the conditions 1 and 2 hold. We must show that W is a subspace. By definition, we must show that W is a vector space. I have written down all the axioms of a vector space, and the ticks correspond to those which we don't have to prove. The first two ticks we already have as part of the conditions of the theorem. The others hold for any subset, not just a subspace. The other axioms hold for any subset, so we don't have to prove the others. They are already there for you. We need to only prove these two. I'll prove this first and this. I'll prove that 0 belongs to W, where the 0 comes from V. Okay, so they share the same additive identity. That must happen, but that's easy. Look at condition 2. From condition 2, which states that for all alpha in R and x in W, I have okay, just choose alpha to be 0, then 0 into x belongs to W for all x in W. But the property, first property that we proved, 0 into x is 0, and so 0 belongs to W. Okay, that's easy. Take the scalar to be 0. So this also holds. So let me remove, I'm sorry, this holds. So let me remove this. We have proved that 0 belongs to W, and this is easy. It's enough just to prove that 0 is in W. This holds in the entire V. We need to show existence of additive inverse. Okay, how do you do that? Take alpha equal to minus 1. Consider the case alpha equal to minus 1. I am again looking at condition 2. condition 2, that is it's closed with respect to scalar multiplication. Take alpha equal to minus 1, then minus 1 into x belongs to w whenever x belongs to w. Property 4 that we proved last time, minus 1 into x is minus x. Minus x belongs to w for all x in w. So that was easy. Okay, so existence of additive identity, that is existence of 0 and existence of negative element, and so w is a vector space in its own right with respect to the same operations of V, and so w is a subspace by definition. Okay, so you need to only verify that to verify that a certain subset is a subspace, you need to only verify that the closure axioms are satisfied. Okay, so let's now look at examples, quite a few of them, examples of subspaces. I have already given one. Let's look at one coming from linear equations, homogeneous linear equations. So I want to list a few subspaces. I'll take this as example 2. Look at V as Rn, by which I mean a real vector space, the underlying field is R. I am given a fixed matrix of order m by n, m rows n columns. I'll define the subspace WA. I'll define the subset W, which depends on A, as the set of all x in Rn such that Ax is equal to 0. This example was given as an example of a vector space. Yesterday's class, I hope you remember, this is a subspace. This is a subspace of Rn. Remember, this is contained in Rn. Okay. A is m cross n, x is in Rn, so the product is m cross 1, so this belongs to Rm. This is a 0 vector of Rm. Okay. To write this in detail, this is 0, 0, etc., 0 that has m coordinates. Then this WA is a subspace. Let me prove this very quickly by using the previous theorem. Let's take, we only need to prove that it's closed with respect to addition and scalar multiplication. So let's take two vectors xy in WA. Then we have AX is equal to 0 and AY equal to 0. Solutions of the homogeneous equation. I must show that x plus y belongs to WA as well as alpha x. Consider z as x plus y. I will call x plus y as z. I must show that AZ is 0. So let us look at AZ. AZ is AX plus y, but I know that matrix multiplication is distributive. This kind of a thing can be split, AX plus AY, that is 0 plus 0, that is 0. So AZ is 0, that is we have shown that Z belongs to WA, and so it is closed with respect to addition. Scalar multiplication, still easy. Suppose AX equal to 0 and alpha is a real number, let us call W. No, W is not a good idea. Z prime as alpha into x. Look at AZ prime, that is A of alpha x. But I know from matrix multiplication, alpha is a scalar. This is alpha into AX, alpha into 0, that is 0. So I have shown that Z prime belongs to W. Okay, I am treating this as the first example of a subspace and proving it in detail that it is indeed a subspace. From the next example onwards, I'll just wave and it means it's an exercise for you. Okay, so this is a subspace. Example 3. You have any questions? Example 3. V is R n cross n this time. The space of square matrices with real entries. Let me define W as the set of all matrices A that satisfy this condition. Okay, let me write like this. The notation, probably I could include that also here. What is Aij? For me, Aij is the ith row jth entry of A, just to confirm this notation. Okay. Ith row jth element is a jth row ith element. These matrices are called symmetric matrices. A equals A transpose. Okay, set of all matrices that satisfy the condition, set of all matrices A that satisfy the condition, A equals A transpose, set of all symmetric matrices. All A such that A transpose equals A. If you are familiar with this operation of taking transpose, the rows become columns, as a result the columns become rows. Look at this subset, okay, it's obviously a subset. This is a subspace. W is a subspace. That is, to verify that W is a subspace, you must ask whether this question has an affirmative answer. If A and B are symmetric matrices, then A plus B symmetric? A plus B is symmetric, obviously you can verify that even if you do not know this equation. If A is symmetric, alpha is scalar, alpha times A, is that symmetric? Yes, okay. So by the previous theorem, these two conditions are enough to verify. So this is a subspace. Let us try and do a similar thing for complex matrices. Okay, this time the underlying field is the field of complex numbers. So V is C n cross n, set of all n cross n matrices whose entries are complex numbers. The underlying field is understood to be C. In this, let me define W as the set of all A such that I'll give a similar definition. Aij is Aji bar. This is called the conjugate transpose. Okay, for all less than or equal to I comma j less than or equal to n. That is, A star equals A, where A star is the conjugate transpose, A bar transpose. To write down an equation similar to A transpose equal to A, I have A star equals A, that is A star is, you take the complex conjugates of the matrix A first and then take the transpose, that is A star. Such matrices are called Hermitian matrices, okay. A is a Hermitian matrix. Sometimes we also use the word self-adjoint. A is a Hermitian matrix. is this a subspace of V? Intuitively, we would say yes. Okay, the answer is no. This is not a subspace of V. The reason is the following. I will not give the proof, but you try to fill up the gaps. You take a Hermitian matrix, the diagonal entries of a Hermitian matrix must be real numbers. Okay. Let me just write down a 2 by 2 Hermitian matrix. This is how it will look like, where this is easy to see, a 2 by 2 Hermitian matrix, just to give you a feel of the fact that this is not a subspace. A 2 by 2 Hermitian matrix has this form, alpha, beta, gamma, delta are real numbers, this will be the complex conjugate of this. The diagonal entries, if you go back and check this, Aii equals Aii bar. So, the diagonal entries will be real numbers. So, if A is Hermitian, then the diagonal entries are real numbers. This is a complex vector space, so the scalar comes from C. Look at I times A. I into A, the diagonal entries are not real. So, it is not a subspace. This is not a subspace of C, but this is a subspace of R. This time the underlying field is R, then this is a subspace. Okay. So, what we have done is to write down a formula similar to the real case, but we observe that this is not a subspace, but it is a real subspace. Okay. That is example 4. So, look at I introduced this notation yesterday. V is okay. Let me introduce W first and then V. Okay, let me say V is C101. This is the vector space. I have not included this yesterday, but you can easily verify that this is a vector space. And what are the elements? The vector space of all differentiable of all ones, at least once differentiable functions whose first derivatives are continuous. Similar to C01. C01 is a vector space of all continuous functions, complex valued continuous functions. This is a complex valued functions which satisfy the property they are at least once differentiable and that the first derivatives are continuous. You can verify this is a vector space. Okay. Basically, two axioms to be verified. If f and g are functions that belong to V, then f plus g belongs to V and alpha times f belongs to V. Essentially, that is what you need to verify. So, this is a vector space. We also know from calculus that if a function is differentiable, then it must be continuous. And so this is a subset V prime. V is C prime 01. Oh, that's not a very good notation. Let's say this is V1 for me, and this is V2. I'll use C01, which I introduced yesterday. This is obviously true because every differentiable function is continuous. This is a subspace. V1 is a subspace of V2, and V1 is not equal to V2 because there are continuous functions which are not differentiable. Okay. That is example 5. I want to go back to example 2 and then specialize it for R2 and R3. The reason why I do this is these examples will be useful a little later when we discuss the notion of linear independence and dimension. Okay, so let's go back to example 2. Example 2 is a set of all solutions of the homogeneous system. Okay, I'm looking at a particular case. So I want to look at this example 6, which is W is the set of all x in R2, the plane, such that x2 equals a fixed constant c x1. C is a fixed constant, a real constant. Okay, this from unitary geometry of two dimensions, we know that this is like y equal to mx plus c. The constant term is 0, so this is the set of all points lying on a certain line whose slope is c, lying on a certain line. Passing through the origin is important. Okay, W is a subspace of R2. W is a subspace of R2. Can you see that W is not the entire R2? And also W is not singleton 0. Okay. Example 7. W is a set of all x in R3 such that, see here I am following the notation that if x is in R2, then x is written as x1 comma x2. Okay, that's a notation that I am using always. X in R3 now. X3 equals A times T, X2 equals B, okay, let's say X1, X2 equals B times T, X3 equals C times T. A, B, C are fixed constants. T is in R. Look at the set of all vectors that satisfy this condition. So can you tell me what this subset of R3 looks like? Is it similar, is it not similar to the previous example? This is also the set of all points lying on a straight line. This is a set of all points lying on a straight line passing through the origin. If you want, you can write down the symmetric form of the line. X1 by A equals X2 by B equals X3 by C. Okay. Please verify that this is a subspace. Set of all points lying on a certain straight line passing through the origin. W is a subspace of R3. I will call this W1, I will define W2 next. W2 is a set of all x in R3 such that, let me use different constants now, C1 x1 plus C2 x2 plus C3 x3 equals 0 for fixed constants C1, C2, C3. I collect all x that satisfy this condition. C1, C2, C3 are fixed numbers. Collect all x that satisfy this condition. What is the geometric interpretation? This is a plane passing through the origin. This is a set of all points lying on a certain plane passing through the origin. Please verify that this is also a subspace. Okay, W2 is a subspace. W1 or W2, they are not the entire R3, they are not 0, okay. There are non-zero vectors in each of these. Let me include this and conclude today's lecture. W equal to 0 is a subspace of any vector space. And this will be called the trivial subspace. Just 0, that is the minimum you need to have for a subspace, okay. For instance, if you want to show that a subset is not a subspace, you show that 0 does not belong to that. This may work out in certain examples. So this is a subspace, because 0 plus 0 is in W, then whatever be alpha, alpha into 0 is in W. So this is a subspace, the trivial subspace. V itself is a subspace. We will be interested in subspaces which are neither V nor singleton 0, those are called proper subspaces. Any subspace W such that W is not singleton 0 and not V will be called a proper subspace. This is called a proper subspace. If you go back to the previous examples, you will you have examples of proper subspaces. Example 4, this is a proper subspace. Not every matrix is a Hermitian matrix. There are continuous functions whose first derivative, there are continuous functions which are not once differentiable. There are points in R2 which don't belong, which do not lie on a certain line passing through the origin. Similar here, this is a plane passing through the origin. There are points in R3 which do not lie on this particular plane passing through the origin, okay. These are all proper subspaces, okay. I will stop here. Tomorrow's lecture we will look at the notion of dimension, that is the notion of linear independence, dimension, and then the notion of basis.